It's Wednesday, October 20th, coming up live on The View. Guest co-host Patricia Heaton's getting into the middle of hot topics. From why Clarence Thomas's wife wants an apology from Anita Hill, to which celebrity sex tape isn't getting anyone too excited, and why Whoopi is outraged over Florence Henderson getting kicked off Dancing with the Stars. And the Red, White, and View is getting a briefing from Homeland Security Secretary Janet Napolitano on illegal immigration, new terror threats, and reports that Bin Laden is living comfortably in Pakistan. Then, the legendary Rod Stewart's revealing if he's ready to be a dad for the eighth time and hitting the stage to kick out a classic.
I get a kick out of you.
All that, hot topics, and more, coming up live on The View.
But I have to, before we start,
yes,
I have a little present for Whoopi and Joy.
Uh-huh. Okay.
Given what happened last week, I think you need this.
Be so calm and carry on.
Do you know, that is so funny, Patricia.
Did you see what it says on the back?
Now panic and freak
now
out.
Now panic and freak out.
If I had had this on that day, he'd have gotten hit with it. So thank you for this. I love this. That's right. So welcome to The View. As you can see, Barbara is not here today. But joining us as our special, special guest co-host is the star of one of the funniest sitcoms on television, child, The Middle.
Oh, yeah.
The fabulous Funny Show.
I do not miss The Middle. Sit down, we watch it, we enjoy it. It is hysterical.
This is your second hit, great hit series. Wow.
God is good.
I'm very fortunate. It's also like great to see a family. Like a family, that goes through real stuff that, you know, still.
I think there hasn't been a show like this on since Roseanne, where people were struggling financially and the things with the kids and all that stuff. And that's true. And in a really funny way. I mean, it just makes you feel great.
It's fantastic.
Remember what happened to Roseanne, though? Once they won the lottery, their numbers, their ratings went down.
Right, no, I don't think the Heck family's going to win the lottery.
Patty, I want to ask you, many people, I've known you for so long, and I call you Patty, but some people call you Patricia. What do you prefer to be called?
I prefer to be called two-time Emmy-winning Patricia Heaton. Nobody ever gets my name right.
Well, listen, two-time Emmy winner Patricia Heaton, on tonight's episode of The Middle, it's based on something in the two-time Emmy-winning Patricia Heaton's life.
Real
you want
life.
To tell us?
Well, tonight's episode is called Foreign Exchange, and it's based on an experience I had last year where I thought it would be a great idea to have a foreign exchange student come and stay with us for 10 days from Japan.
In real life,
to broaden my son's horizons and help them get outside of their box a little. And when I was growing up, the people across the street, Dick and Mary Jo Green, had invited four Italian guys to come and stay with them when we were growing up.
What were their names?
Marco, 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 and Beppe. And these guys proceeded to hit on all the girls in the neighborhood. In fact, you know, my friend came over and said, and the Marcos and Beppe want to take us to Dairy Queen. And my dad's like, you're not going anywhere with those guys. So, but I thought it would be nice. So we had a nice Japanese boy came over to our house this last year, and he was kind of the same sullen teenager that my boys were, and sat and didn't talk for 10 days and kind of stared at us just like my boys do. So,
did he know who you were? Like, you're Patricia Heaton?
Well, he kept saying things like, I think he had this thing that my producer had said, this kid is going to think everybody in America has a mom who's on a TV show and lives in a house with a swimming pool. And he kind of did look at us like, wow, what a life. We went by a yoga place and he said, yoga is for rich people. And I was like, really has. Well, and also, every time they brought him food at a restaurant, the plate would be as big as this table.
Right.
You know? Yeah. The Coke was this big. So he did get this interesting impression of America.
So they based this...
So our show tonight... Well, the Heck family has a little bit of a different life. and their idea of showing him America is eating fast food and watching The Bachelor. It doesn't go very well.
It's a shame he's not here now, because then he could see the other part of America. Anita Hill made headlines in 1991 for accusing Supreme Court Justice Clarence Thomas of sexual harassment. And Hill just got this voicemail now, 19 years later, from Clarence Thomas's wife. Now, I would like to do a dramatic rendition of this, if you would allow
me. Go right ahead. Emmy Award-winning Whoopi Goldberg.
The phone rings.
Oscar.
Yes. Sorry. The phone rings.
Yes.
That's a good phone.
I just wanted to reach across the airwaves and the years to ask you to consider something. I would love you to consider an apology sometime and a full explanation of why you did what you did with my husband. So give it some thought, and certainly pray about this, and help us understand why you did what you did. Okay, have a nice day.
Now that's what Clarence Thomas's wife, that's the message she left for Anita Hill.
Left this message on Anita Hill's...
19 years later.
And of course, Anita Hill thought it was a prank, so she called the campus police, because she's a professor, and then discovered that it wasn't a prank, and now it's gone up the ranks. But what do you think she was thinking?
I think there was a little drunk dialing involved there.
Well, it was 7:30 a.m.
Well, maybe she started with a screwdriver in the morning. I don't know.
But what she said when they asked her, she said she was extending the olive branch to Anita Hill. But it's like 19 years... Let it go. And what is and Anita Hill said, and I'm not going to apologize because that constitutes that I did something wrong.
That's right.
And I didn't do anything
wrong. There's a possibility. The woman, Mrs. Thomas, is the founder of a right-wing group called Liberty Central. She's very political. Their motive is to unseat Obama, et cetera, on the left. And she's getting a salary from anonymous donors. So it's pot, and I don't think that that's considered kosher when you're married to a Supreme Court justice. So what I'm thinking is she's getting a little heat for that, and maybe this is a distraction from that.
What do you think?
But it's
an interesting story to start to uncover. You have to wonder and then go on to investigate that.
But what is it draws more attention to everything, though?
It certainly does, and I think maybe in life you kind of get to a point where it's sort of seeking like closure on issues, and maybe personally, I think there's the assumption that you can only forgive if someone says they're sorry, be it if they did something wrong or not.
I don't know if an apology is going to give her closure so she can look at Clarence Thomas and go, okay, now I believe
you. You know what someone told me one time? No other person can give you closure. You have to give yourself closure.
Sure,
no matter what anybody does or doesn't do, you're the only one who can provide closure to yourself.
Do you think that Mrs. Thomas doesn't believe that her husband's
side? Sometimes I think wives, we will stay, but there's always a little speck of doubt. Mm. And as we look at them, there's a little thing in our head that we choose to suppress. Well, I don't know if she feels like this
19 years later, let it go. If Anita hasn't called you and said, look, I want to talk, girl. If she hasn't called you, she probably doesn't want
to apologize.
I'm
gonna apologize.
And you
need to let it go.
We have Janet Napolitano here, Homeland Security.
Yeah, she was one of the team attorneys for
Anita Hill today. Now, Oscar.
Now, I don't usually get worked up over stuff, especially dancing with...
What are you worked up over, Whoopi?
Every now and then, I hit my limit, like all of you. But this is beyond everything, even beyond the other day.
What's wrong?
Dancing with the damn stars.
What happened,
Whoopi? I cannot believe that they cut Florence Henderson.
They knocked her off.
And Florence will be here tomorrow. You know, she was voted off the show last night. But the chick in the monkey suit, she's still there.
Oh, God, wait a second.
She's still
there. That's Rachel Palin.
She don't have an ounce of rhythm. She is still there. Why is she there?
I woke up in the middle of the show. I thought I was watching Planet of the Apes.
But now, Whoopi, she takes it off. It didn't get better, though. But I ask you, do you think that kiss from Barry Williamson, who played Greg Brady, who played Florence Henderson, son of the Brady Bunch, maybe did Florence Henderson in?
Well, I have to tell you, a lot of people say to me, you know, Sherry represents a lot of people in the United States. So I can only assume that you pointing it out and talking about how sort of grossed out by it you were. They thought, oh, she shouldn't be dancing anymore.
No, well, then
I apologize personally.
It's all your fault, Sherry.
No, I'll tell you what it is. It's fan base, and the votes are based on calls and texts. Okay, so I guess I would assume that if you looked into it and saw who was texting, it would come from a certain age bracket, and maybe her fan base is not texting.
Wait a second. The text message her fan base is her mother's fan base. The Tea Party is they not only vote in the primaries, they're going to vote for this also to keep their girl out there.
Get ready, Joy. I told you what they want.
Maybe take a page from the Tea Party. This will probably
this is Dancing with the Stars. This is like
it's deeper. It's so much deeper than that. Because Bristol Palin stayed on.
I watch anything but the middle and that's it. And that and good horror movies. That's all I can handle.
What do you think about it?
I think, like Joy, everything leads to the Tea Party, doesn't it?
Well, they vote, honey. The Mama Grizzlies are out there pushing the vote. Why not?
And now, a word from our sponsor.
Okay, you know, everyone has personal motivations for wanting to lose weight. Maybe you have a reunion coming up. You're trying to get back into your skinny jeans, if you're a skinny bitch. And maybe you want to lose the baby weight you gained because you realize your kid is applying to college, okay? Watch. Well, you're not going to lose weight if you're snacking on key lime pie, strawberry shortcake, and blueberry pie. When you're at that point in the middle of the day, when you're craving something sweet and satisfying and your willpower is being put to the test, Yoplait Light can help you outsmart temptation with 30 delicious flavors, all around 100 calories each. It's a delicious way to cut calories to help you lose weight. It's so good, Yoplait. It tastes like dessert.
Yeah.
Now, Yoplait wants you to look and feel your best by feeling good about your weight and your appearance. To help you achieve your goals, members of our audience are receiving Yoplait Keep Fit Kits packed with cool exercise gear. Yay!
Crazy music we had. You know what? We're gonna go and we'll come right back because we've got more Hot Topics. A sad farewell to two legendary sitcom parents. Beaver's mom on Leave It to Beaver, Barbara Billingsley, who passed away on Saturday at 94. Yeah. And Happy Days dad, Tom Bosley, who died yesterday at 83.
Yeah, he was very good.
He was
you should rent a movie called Love with the Proper Stranger with Natalie Wood and Steve McQueen. Yeah. He is so funny in that movie.
And
the movie's great.
Actor. They were wonderful actors. And who can forget Barbara Billingsley in Airplane? Yeah. Talking about she spoke jive and then got up and did this whole thing. It was brilliant. I mean, so goodbye and good speed. Now, Tea Party candidate for Delaware Senate, Christine O'Donnell, has had her share of public image issues throughout her campaign. And a debate with opponent Chris Coons yesterday really didn't help. Take a look.
Where in the Constitution is separation of church and state? Let me just clarify.
Please.
You're telling me that the separation of church and state is found in the First Amendment.
Government shall make no establishment of church.
That's in the First Amendment.
Oh! She's now saying that the words separation of church and state do not appear in the First Amendment, which they don't. It's a phrase that was coined by Thomas Jefferson.
Yes.
But that's not what she said there. She said, are you telling me that?
Well, but her camp also put out a statement saying that it wasn't like a literal question of does a separation of church and state appear in the First Amendment.
Should know that.
But they were questioning the concept of separation of church and state.
But he went on to then quote something that is indeed in the First Amendment, I believe.
Yes.
And then she said, that's in the First Amendment, so she would have just stopped. Yeah. She would have at least had an ounce of an argument.
She's a Democratic plant, is what I think.
That's how bad she is.
Don't put her on us, baby. That was yours.
I'm pretty sure it's you guys.
But you know what? Thank God we have a First Amendment. We'd never know how stupid she is.
Well, but in defense of Christine O'Donnell, Rush Limbaugh said the same thing.
Oh, yeah.
He said the
Another
same thing.
Brain trust.
Well, let me read what the First Amendment actually says. Congress shall make no law respecting an establishment of religion or prohibiting the free exercise thereof or abridging the freedom of speech or of the press, or of the right of the people peaceably to assemble and to petition the government for redress of grievances.
You know, let me point out, it is the First Amendment. It is not the 10th, it is not the 20th. It's the first, because it's the most important one, in my opinion.
Most important one to
if
know.
If you don't have that, you've got no democracy.
No, I don't know. Somebody said that she asked, because I didn't see it, she asked Koontz to list the other four freedoms in the First Amendment. Was he able to? I don't know.
He's a constitutional scholar.
What is his quiz back? Like, I don't take that. Name the 14.
It's a game show. Let's move on.
13.
The head writer of Sesame Street adopted an Ethiopian girl, but once she started telling him that she wanted straight blonde hair, he created this video to help her see how beautiful she is. Take a look.
I love my hair. I love my hair. I love it and I have to share. I love my hair. I love my hair. I want to make the world aware. I love my hair.
That's good. Oh.
You know, whooping. It's so crazy. I'm so glad that they made this video because there's a lot of little black girls who, you know, we don't have a lot of images of us. And so, you know, it's a lot of self-esteem problems.
Well,
but Whoopi did this.
Like that too. May I just point out, as Caucasian, I also had curly hair, and the low self-esteem about that hair starts very young.
It starts very young. But Whoopi did this on your, I remember you did it on your HBO special where you wore the towel. You were so ahead of your time because you did this exact same thing about loving yourself and loving your hair. And you broke the mold for people because people weren't able to wear locks to work. They would get fired. Yeah. And Whoopi Goldberg opened the door for people to wear their hair just like you wear your hair and nobody questions it.
'60s and '70s came along, and we all had afros again.
But this is what bugs me is, you know, people make this comment. You know, why doesn't
there I am? Look at that.
Look at this face.
Oh wow, they pulled that one out.
Pull that picture up.
Look at me. That's my real
You're
natural hair.
Like Natasha, that's what you look like.
Beyonce or somebody. It's like I should sing when I was that age. What was I thinking?
I don't know Beyonce.
I couldn't sing.
Then you did do a music video. But people always talk about...
You do.
You look damn good.
Good.
You don't look bad now, but you look really interesting.
You refer to me as the Emmy Award winning, good looking Joy Behar. Thank you.
What were you trying to say?
I'm saying, you know, it really bugs me because I love the video, the Sesame Street video, when people say, well, how come Michelle Obama doesn't go natural? There's been a lot of comments. I keep hearing that on the fringes. How come she, you know, Malia and Sasha don't do their hair natural?
I've heard that
and
too.
I want to put this to bed because black women, we have different ways of doing our hair. We choose to go in locks, in braids, in different types of ways. But Madam C.J. Walker came out back way when, Whoopi, and she made the pressing comb.
Yes.
It's about manageability. That's what it is. Yeah. Michelle Obama has a lot to do. We relax our hair. We press our hair.
Why is there so much pressure on black women, too, to wear their hair natural? White women don't wear their hair natural. I'm a
brunette. Hardly anybody wears their hair naturally.
So this little comment that I keep hearing about Michelle Obama needs to wear hair.
People just need to bitch about Michelle Obama, child.
Can I get my plug really quickly?
Get your plug.
And speaking of self-esteem with black girls, I'm going to be in Atlanta with Steve Harvey and Marjorie Harvey for the Girls Who Rule the World Rock because it's 100 black girls and we're talking to them about self-esteem, loving yourself, your hair, and just making it as a teenager this Saturday in Atlanta. So I'm so excited. I'm not wearing a wig. I'm going to take the hair off.
And the lashes.
Am I going to take the lashes off?
You're going to take the lashes off?
Too far. I mean, the only thing I get to keep are my boobs. Those are the only real thing.
Well, those actually belong to you. They came with the package. Because, you know, self-esteem is a strange thing. You know, we get all of us, all women, I think, are told so many different things. We were talking about Venus de Milo.
We were in Italy this summer and saw that beautiful painting of Venus on the half shell, and she was blonde.
Oh,
and all these Italian women, of course, have dark hair, and once they saw that, they started bleaching their hair with horse urine. to make it blonde.
Make it,
so this is this thing
the idea of
the blonde,
of what was beauty.
Blonde.
It's been going
Botticelli.
On for a very long time.
It's the Botticelli it's painting, not the statue of Venus
yeah,
de Milo.
The Botticelli yes, painting, Venus on the half shell. Yes.
Well,
Venus Rising.
Yeah. That's right.
So this is this thing of having to look like Elizabeth has been going on for a long time,
she's
and
Elizabeth.
We're very bitter about
she
it, by the way.
Like Here's
the
thing. Look
Elizabeth
like
doesn't look like Elizabeth. I'm just saying.
That's what I said. All women, no one goes natural, really. I mean.
Except we're naturally wearing purple today.
That's right.
For yes. Spirit Day, which yes. honors young people. Yes. And this is to honor young people who have been victims of anti-gay bullying. And the U.S. military just took a major step in promoting tolerance and acceptance. For the first time, they're allowing recruiters to accept openly gay and lesbian applicants.
Yeah.
This is, you know, to me, if you wanna go fight for our country, yeah. if you, cause I'm not gonna go, but if you wanna go fight
no
for our country,
are,
I yeah. don't care what you're,
right.
what else is going on, as long as you're doing what you're supposed to do.
Thank you, exactly.
Yeah. I don't care.
Yep.
You know, I know.
She's got a girl.
Elizabeth.
Yes.
What's going on, girl?
It's an incredible cause, by the way. Well, thanks. Hey, by the way, off subject, tonight at 4, 7, and 10 p.m. Eastern, I will be at QVC showing everyone how to get a tight tummy with the Ab Glider from ProForm.com. And members of today's audience are going home with a $200 gift card to use on ProForm.com.
I have that in my house. I love that thing. It's the greatest. Oh, yeah, I use it. It's the one thing that I actually do do. And we'll be right back with Homeland Security Secretary Janet Napolitano.
Major players in U.S. politics, and whether it's keeping America safe from terrorism or dealing with the hot-button issue of illegal immigration, the buck stops with this woman. Please welcome back Secretary of Homeland Security, Janet Napolitano.
Nice to be back.
Great to have you. First time we've been here together. We were talking in Hot Topics about Anita Hill and wife of Supreme Court Justice Clarence Thomas putting a message out to her. You were on her legal team, Anita Hill's, at the time. What do you think of this whole situation now?
I think it's time to move on.
Yes, absolutely.
19 years ago, move on.
Yeah.
One other thing we wanted to talk about, agreed. just yesterday, I believe, lawmakers in 14 states were looking to change the 14th Amendment, talking about anchor children denying citizenship to those born of illegal immigrants in this country. What are your thoughts there? And do you think that movement will have any sort of weight?
Well, look, it's 14 states, but look, we are enforcing our immigration laws in unprecedented ways right now. It's a story that really hasn't gotten out, but we have actually, in the last 2 years, removed more people from the country who were here illegally than ever before. We've been focusing just for last year.
Yeah.
And half of those were convicted felons. I mean, in other words, we've been focusing on those who are in our jails, in our prisons, making sure after they serve their sentence, they get removed from the country.
And
we're going to continue that kind of focus.
But you're being criticized for not going after people who commit minor offenses. How do you respond to that?
Look, I say, look, I've been a prosecutor for a long time. I was a U.S. attorney. I was an attorney general. You've always got to set priorities. I think in the immigration world, we're not giving anybody a pass. If they come, if we come across them, we enforce the law, but we're going to focus on those who've committed crimes.
But there was this particular case of a DUI where the guy was let off and then he killed a nun, a vehicular homicide.
Right.
I mean, you know, we believe that DUIs, their cars should be taken away from them, their licenses, after the first offense, because the second one could kill me. So, I mean, that is not a minor offense.
It is not a minor offense, and we've actually gone back and said, what happened several years ago that that individual was allowed back on the street and wasn't already deported. We're going to make sure that problem gets fixed.
What about, on that note, though, Meg Whitman up in California, we know that she had employed an illegal alien allegedly for 9 years, okay? So some would say, okay, that would be maybe fall under that category of minor crime. Bill O'Reilly asked you when you were on his show what the government was going to do about that. at the time you didn't have an answer. Do you have one now?
Did you walk off the set?
What is it?
and here it is.
I've got a pillow for you if you need it.
We will treat her the way we would treat anybody else in a similar circumstance. So Immigration and Customs Enforcement will take whatever action it would normally take in that circumstance. But let me go back to my major point, which is this. This administration is enforcing the rule of law. We are enforcing the immigration laws. The numbers that need to go up are going up. The numbers that need to be going down are going down. We've put more resources at the border than ever before, and I know that border very well. Mm-hmm. I'm from the border. I know it very well. So it's very reinforced now. At some point in time, we hope Congress takes up immigration reform, but until that point in time, we are going to enforce the law.
Okay. What is the difference between what Arizona is trying to do now and your secure communities program where you're fingerprinting, you're sending fingerprints of convicted criminals to different states to you know, see their records. But the administration is kind of not up for what Arizona is doing of checking people's documentation. So how is that different?
Right, I can say as the former Attorney General and Governor of Arizona, right. So I have a little experience with Arizona. Yeah. What Arizona was doing was actually setting its own immigration law. What Secure Communities does is says, look, if you are being booked in a jail or prison and we're running your fingerprints against the FBI criminal databases, mm-hmm. we're going to also now run them against the immigration databases. That allows us to focus on those who are committing crimes. That allows us to find those serious criminals who are here illegally and make sure they don't get out. When they serve their sentence, they come into our system, they're detained, they're removed from the country.
Right. Now you were Attorney General and Governor of Arizona. Yep. The federal government, they're suing Arizona over this new immigration law. And being a former Attorney General and Governor, what do you think of the law?
I vetoed a similar law when I was mm-hmm. the governor because I thought it was bad law enforcement policy, number one. And the law enforcement groups asked me to veto it. They want to be able to focus on other crimes.
They don't want to be responsible for checking status.
Immigration status, uh-huh. exactly right. But we also can't live in a country where we have 50 different immigration laws. That's not the way we're set up. Yeah. We need a federal law, and we need to enforce it, which we are doing. That's the point. That's the story that needs to be told, is that we are enforcing that immigration law with numbers that are unprecedented. At some point in time, Congress will have to take up immigration. They will have to do it in a bipartisan fashion. President Obama has asked them to do that,
What's
has supported
them
that.
So long?
It's a difficult issue. It takes Congress a long time to handle difficult issues.
Everybody's so impatient with Obama. He's only been there, 20 months? Yeah. For goodness sakes. Yeah.
Janet, I want to change the tack just a little bit about Osama bin Laden, because for years we've been told that, you know, we can't find him. He's over here living in caves, and now it's being reported that he is absolutely living comfortably in homes in Pakistan. Why can we not find this man?
Yeah. Look, can we Google him?
He's got to have a Facebook page.
Get child services on him.
Get child services on him.
Like you said, AARP.
Find him like that.
We've given you 7 suggestions.
Hey, listen.
Where is this man?
Hey, listen. The president, his number one value is the safety and security of the American people. And that's, he wakes up every day thinking about it. I wake up every day thinking about it. And go to bed thinking about what do we need to do to keep the American people safe and secure. And that means the hunt for bin Laden goes on, but it also means also other al-Qaeda operatives. It also means other al-Qaeda wannabes, and some of them are in our country now. They're U.S. persons. That is an evolution that has actually occurred over the last few years, where we have U.S. persons themselves radicalized to the point of violence who are now starting to act out.
Quickly before we go, are we more ready to handle an attack should one occur than we were September 2000.
Absolutely. And we will continue to work those issues, work safety, work security every day.
I think it's great that a woman is keeping us safe. Got to say it right here from the ladies at The View. We'll be right back with Rod Stewart. Thank you.
Oh, God.
Well, we needed to see that.
Just shoot me. Rod Stewart is about to be a father for the 8th time. That's right. And he just gave birth to his 5th American songbook, a CD called Fly Me to the Moon. He's here today to show us what he does best. I think that's singing. So please welcome back Rod Stewart.
We met the wife.
We met the lovely wife. Take a shot of your wife. What's her name again?
Penny. Penny Lancaster.
Penny Lancaster. Beautiful.
Number 8 is about
wife or child?
Wife.
Second. 3.
This is number 3?
Three marriages.
And Penny, wait, when is Penny
due? The child is?
February.
End of February.
A boy.
Oh, yeah.
What are you going to name him?
Can I tell?
Yeah.
Aiden.
Aiden Stewart. I love it.
Aiden Stewart.
Now, this is your 5th American songbook. 17 million, my Aunt Julie loves it, 17 million copies have been sold. You still, I mean, are there any songs left to record after this?
Yeah, there's hundreds and hundreds. It could go, I could record another 5 albums.
Really? There's so many great standards.
Oh, it goes on and on and on.
Why do you think people really flock to it? Why do they love it? Why are standards standards?
Well, they're beautiful songs, well-crafted, beautiful lyrics. And it's the old cliché, they don't write them like that anymore.
Yeah. They can't write them anymore like that?
I haven't heard any.
So. How does it compare for you to have had a rock career and then now sing these standards? Are you loving discovering all these standards and do you prefer one to the other?
No, not really. I think I'm a... Oh, show me leg. I'm a rocker at heart, but these... As a singer, they're a challenge. They're always a challenge, these songs. Yeah. I never get tired of singing them. No. But as I said, I'm a rocker at heart.
Right. Yes.
But not always, because wasn't your family, I know, used to gather around and, like, sing around the piano. Didn't you hide under the piano? So how did you go from the kid under the piano, afraid to sing and join into where you are now?
Well, we used to have these, you know, the Stewart family used to have these big parties at Christmas and birthdays, and everyone come over and get drunk. And little Roddy was always sent up to bed early. When I heard all the noise, I'd creep down into the front room and under the piano. Oh. So I'd see all these bare legs with men with kilts on.
What was under the kilt?
No, nothing at all, just the old block and tackle. And it was it.
I like that phrase.
The bird's eye view.
I learned quite a lot at those parties about block and tackle. Moving on, Gabe.
Let's talk about your wife for a second. She's 39, and you are. She's young, and you're quite a bit older than her. But you look great. I mean, it's all about how you look and feel, right?
Yeah, absolutely.
But is there an issue about with you at all?
Not at all. I mean, I think probably when people talk about age difference, if the girl's 17 and the guy's 39 or 40, but the older the two of you get, it seems to balance out.
Until you hit 90 and then she's 40.
It's okay. Listen.
Then it can be weird.
Joy, I'm a very fit 65-year-old. I intend to be a very fit 85-year-old.
I believe you.
You and Penny, you've been very, very open about the fact that you used IVF to conceive. What was that like? Because I know I did in vitro fertilization, so it's sometimes a hard journey. How has it been for you and Penny?
It is. It was heartbreaking, really, a couple of times where we thought we were close, but we'd failed. But the bit I always enjoyed was getting the sperm in a bottle and getting in a Ferrari and taking it down the hospital a million miles an hour.
And you're trying not to drop it. That's liquid gold.
Absolutely. And also, I had to give my wife injections in the bottom at 6 o'clock every night.
Yes.
Oh, I did enjoy that.
This November, you're going to be at the Coliseum at Caesar's Palace, right, in Vegas? That's excellent. Is that a show?
So excited.
In November. Yeah,
did you say? Right? November, yeah.
That's fun.
Just for 2 weeks.
So go see him.
Wait, nice. I love your music. Are you going to sing today?
Yes, indeed.
Stay. When we come back, Rod is singing. I get a kick out of you. Fly Me to the Moon. We're going to be right back.
From his his new CD, Fly Me to the Moon, The Great American Songbook, Volume 5. Please welcome back the fabulous Rod Stewart.
I get no kick from champagne. Mere alcohol doesn't thrill me at all. So tell me, why should it be true that I get a kick out of you? I get no kick from cocaine. I'm sure that if I took even one sniff, it would bore me terrifically too. But I get a kick out of you. Yeah. I get a kick every time. Kick, though it's clear to see that jobbiously don't adore me. I get no kick in a plane, flying too high with some girl in the sky is my idea of nothing to do. Kick every time I see you standing there before me. I get a kick, though it's clear to see that you obviously do not adore me. Listen. Yes, I do. You give me a thrill every time I see that fabulous face.
Bravo, bravo. Hey, listen. Thanks to Rod Stewart. Members of our studio audience are going home with Rod's CD, baby. You will love it. We'll be right back. Hey, Patricia Heaton is going to be back with us tomorrow to guest co-host. Rod Stewart, we love you. We love this album. If you don't have it, go out and get it. And everybody in the audience, take a little time to do what?
Enjoy the music.
All right now, see you tomorrow.